Can we hear me? All right, just checking. First, I just want to thank Tribeca for having us here. I'm really excited about what the week has in store. Again, Miles Perkins here. I run the industry management for the Unreal Engine in film and television space. So I want to introduce some of my folks here, my friends. Mariana, she's originally from Mexico City, where she left behind her love of lucha libre and moved to Los Angeles to pursue a career in visual effects for major motion pictures. Bent on helping studios of all shapes and sizes, she's focused on virtual production tools for content creators around the world, leading Glassbox Technologies. So great to have you.
Thank you.
And over here, we have Liz. Liz is a producer and head of production at the Third Floor. Third Floor is a world-renowned visualization house. A 10-year veteran of visual effects-driven media oversight, including projects like The Avengers Endgame, The Mandalorian, and also worked client-side on Tim Miller's Terminator Dark Fate. Liz has a talent for seeking opportunities where others see challenges and continues to find and grow talent by empowering others with information, technology, and production workflows. These are all essential in the industry that we're in. So thank you, Liz, for joining us. And my friend, Felix, has a passion for creating story-driven interactive content through real-time workflows. He's the CEO, creative director, and co-founder, as if that's not enough, of Happy Mushroom, and also my friend, as I said. And his extensive career leading virtual production art departments, what you'll refer to as VADs, you will hear. And his extensive career leading these has provided him with a deep understanding of the creative pipeline in all phases, between pre-production, production, and post-production. This has put him at the forefront of the virtual production industry, and with his work on such projects as The Mandalorian, he's really been able to come up with a filmmaker-first approach. So with that, we're going to break this into three parts as we discuss this. And again, this is Fix-It and Pre. We're going to talk about the history. A little bit, how did we get here, where we are today, and then a little bit about the future. So I want to start off by, I'm going to ask you, and I'm not going to do this all the time, but I'm going to go down the line. What is virtual production?
All right. And we get this a lot, right? So for Glassbox and for me personally, like, virtual production is production. You know, if you're a traditional filmmaker, don't be, you know, like, feel overwhelmed or scared about the concept. It's just you go on set, it's the same thing, only there's a virtual component to it. You have a virtual camera, right? Like, if you're doing a location scouting, you have a virtual location scouting. You may be doing it inside a virtual reality, or may you be doing it just like in the computer, Google Earth, something like that. So basically anything that you think about filmmaking, like production, just add the digital, the virtual component to it, and that's it, virtual production.
Yeah.
You guys have anything to add to that?
Yeah, I like to think of it as combining the digital world with the physical world, because right now virtual production is so many things, and I love that it is so many things. And if you think about when cinema first began or when filmmaking first began, we didn't have the opportunity to leverage digital tools. In this day and age, we do. So we can fix things in post, but we can also fix things in pre.
I think virtual production is where before it was hard for people in pre-production to interact with the digital space. Virtual production bridges that barrier of entry. So it's really just a way for traditional filmmakers to interact with the digital space, in my opinion.
I think we all understand that many of these techniques have been around for the past 20 years. Whether we're talking about, we're talking about anything like pre-viz, pitch-viz, tech-viz, VCAM as well. I mean, these things are tools that have been around. What is different right now? What sets us apart right now, today?
well, I think, you know, technology, like back in the day, you know, you can if anybody saw, you know, of course, Avatar and the making of Avatar and James Cameron, how that was made. But of course, back then, it was very, you know, only like James Cameron could afford it or those types of production. But of course, now, you know, technology has definitely shifted and now it's really, at everyone's hands. Like, for example, with Unreal Engine, you know, it's free, anyone can download it, anyone can use it. And so now the technology is affordable. It's kind of like democratized for everyone to use. Everyone can have an iPad and use it as a virtual camera or your iPhone. You know, you can have a low-cost motion capture suit. So now that's what's different today, is that we have more computing power, right? Like GPUs, everything has accelerated, and we have these amazing tools that are allowing us to have this real-time, you know, real-time technologies to everyone's.
I'd like to spring off of what she said. Everything being faster allowed more individuals, more brains to be involved. So back when I was working at the third floor for eight years almost, we worked a lot with directors, but production designers, DPs, set decorators, model makers weren't really considered as much. Real time is all of a sudden making it faster where those individuals could be engaged. That's not something that was available before. So now, a DP, instead of looking at something grayscale, he could look at something that's well lit. And the GI inside of Unreal makes it accurate enough where they want to engage. Where before, they didn't want to work in the Lego room, right? They wanted to work in something more realistic. So I think that's one of the biggest changes. Now I get to work with not only directors, but I get to work with the whole range of creatives that would be in pre-production.
Yeah, I think we're seeing this trend where we're able to bridge that gap, as someone was saying, where we're able to hand, you know, a creative, a client, an iPad or a virtual camera and say something like, hey, you know, that's the Alexa film back. That's a 35 millimeter lens. Okay, I'm used to this. Point it. Wow, okay, I'm actually able to come up with my ideas in real time, quickly. And, you know, instead of having to sit behind an artist and tell them to move the bus or move it to the left, no, to your other left. So they're actually able to hold on and do this stuff and, you know, collaborate and have these conversations that are just, you know, epic to the whole process, the filmmaking process.
So the one thing that I find interesting about this is we're kind of talking about, I always say that it's kind of like the byproducts of what's virtual. Like, everybody had to do something that was, you know, I'm going to introduce a dinosaur, I'm going to introduce this, which couldn't be done before. But it, like I said, it came with those byproducts. Mm-hmm. I always say it's kind of like the pharmaceutical commercial, where it's going to fix this one thing, but everything else is going to fall off your body, right? Creatively, right? And that interaction. Can you talk a little bit about what you've seen in that transition in working with filmmakers who maybe aren't really like into the technical aspect of it, you know, and how do we interact with them? What is that difference?
I'll go. Well, I think the difference is now the ability to visualize, because, you know, as we've been saying with visual effects, it's all these green screens and, you know, like tennis balls. It's not really conducive for the creative process, not for directors, production designers, or even visual effects artists themselves, right? And it's very hard to visualize, and that's why post-production became, and visual effects became so expensive and so slow in the process, because, you know, by the time the director or the supervisor is finally able to visualize what they shot back then with the green screen, so much time has gone by that then, of course, it's like 97 versions to, you know, get a smoke to look right. Whereas now with, for example, with the engine, with the light, you have the lighting and you have the effects, which are the most expensive part of a pipeline. Now you get it for free instead of Unreal Engine, right? So you're able to show everyone, just visualize, iterate. And it's just like that creative process that you're able to make decisions faster. You know, you're just able to do that, visualize, right? Which is now why we're calling this fix it in pre-production, because instead of like, oh, fix it in post, no. Like, just take your time in pre-production and just really visualize, iterate, get creative, right?
Well, let me actually go on to that, because with your company, you guys, one of the tools that you have, which is really amazing, is the VCam. And my assumption is that this is not for layout, this is for DPs, in an area where traditionally they have not been invited in. Can you talk a little bit? I mean, what does that mean? Like, what is the vocabulary that you use as you're developing your tools?
Well, I will just use the same exact language that all filmmakers have, because you want to get them to realize that it's just, I mean, not just like, you know, I know some filmmakers are going to be like, no, but that's not an Arri or that's not an Alexa. And that's totally fine. But we are at least giving you the option to visualize. And for those that don't know, VCAM is just a virtual camera where you can hold your iPhone or an iPad and just use it as your, you know, magic window into this like virtual scenes, into the virtual world. And as long as you speak the same language, whether it's, you know, on lensing information, on, you know, like how can you do a rack focus? And when they see, when they realize, and you're right. And you know, with a virtual camera, you are able to use it in layout or just like as the virtual art department, or you can use it for blocking, animation, many things. But you're right, like before, they weren't invited in. And now you can just like during the pandemic, you're able to just ship an iPad to someone. They can just, even if they're not technical, but they know their cameras, and then they're able to visualize the scene and then start recording, playback, you know, reviewing. And that's a really important part of the process where they now also are invited in and are able to realize what the opportunities for the future are.
Yeah. And so in talking a little bit again about engaging with the filmmakers, can you guys tell me a little bit, I mean, because you guys have also been in that previs world. What is the difference between then and now? Because, I mean, I think there was always this kind of thing, almost like a little bit of animosity there was between the DP and Previz, because basically they get this thing that is like locked them into a corner. Mm-hmm. How are you engaging?
I think I've worked with a lot of production designers, and one thing that is changing that I used to hear time and time again is, you know, I feel like I'm making the movie in pre, again in production, and again in post. And so one major part that the process is very beneficial in is you're going to be working in the, if you plan it appropriately, that's a big part, if you plan it appropriately, you can create a pipeline where everything you're building in pre is exactly what you're going to use all the way through post. And so that has huge benefits. For example, you could have an environment artist or someone that is creating assets in 3D, but then a storyboard artist that draws on top of it. And so all of a sudden you have these worlds that are the actual worlds that are going to be used all the way through to the end. And so it's these hybrids that allow the production designer, the DP, the director, and all these different roles that weren't involved in pre-production to actually engage, because things are faster, because the Unreal Engine is allowing us to have not only the lighting fidelity, but also because they're investing in these tools so that all of those brains are involved at once.
Yeah, if you think about it, the most expensive part of the process is the post. And you have companies like Weta, ILM, these experts that are so great at, you know, creating whatever the content is, the digital content is. But if you can minimize the amount of plates that are bad plates, what I mean by that is, you know, someone's shooting on set and there's a green screen and there's supposed to be a monster behind them and they're trying to visualize what that looks like. But if they're actually able to see that monster on an LED wall, see the animation come in, they're actually able to get their shot. And you have all these creatives that are collaborating and having these conversations instead of going back to a time where, well, if I, you know, when you're on set, well, if I knew you were going to do that, I would have, you know, set this up or planned for this. So it's really having those smart conversations early on to help minimize the amount of money, time, and effort that goes into the post process.
I'd like to add to that as well. I think we entered a stage for a while there, we entered a stage where it was like a number crunching game. Oh, well, we have these many shots. How much is that going to cost? And that's a little bit toxic, especially since we're creatives, right? We're all creatives. I think what's changing is, and I've worked on Avengers, I've worked on some of the largest films, directors can now visualize their films, but then they could count on their counterparts to do their jobs as well. So the production designer could come in and design at the same time. And the DP, when production designers are painting or whenever the concept artist is making these paintings, they typically draw with very wide lenses, right? And that's expensive. If you have to build everything for everything, it's expensive. But as soon as the DP comes in, he's using a 50, a 90, and he's going whoop. So all of a sudden you think you're gonna build, you go from building a large set to a small set. And that's how you save. DPs used to not be involved in pre. They used to come in production, but if you bring them early and you use some of these tools, you're able to scale things down. And that's one of the easiest way to save on your budget.
So it's interesting that you're saying that, though, because traditionally, I mean, I think that this new way, which is really the old way, right? Mm-hmm. It's really how we used to make film, which is prepare. Like, if you want to shoot something, make it and shoot it, right? So in thinking about that, how do you engage everybody? Because, I mean, like, I'll throw out one problem, continuity, right? In people's contracts, there's that continuity thing, right? Where you got to hire them in the beginning all the way through. How do you engage with every single department head early on? Like, this kind of seems like an agile workflow mm-hmm. as opposed to the traditional workflow, which is challenging for people to understand mm-hmm. a new way or the old way of working.
There's new review processes now that allow all of the creatives to have a day together. So I think I like to compare it similar to 60s and the 70s. Back when there was filmmaking, if you had a shot in the desert, you would all visit the desert together. And you know, you would bring your DP, you'd bring your writer, you know, this is the desert. And I mean, if you're gonna make the trip and bring all those people and bring all the lights and bring all the cameras, you're gonna use the desert for as much as you can. You know, you're gonna milk it for all that you can. And that's the process that we're trying to introduce people to at Happy Mushroom. We really want to have everyone visit the desert. And every week, you sit down together and you virtually scout your environment, and that could be desert, or that could be Mars, or that could be in New York, or that could be any place in the world, because Unreal is enabling you to do that. So a large part of it is about getting them together and then creating a blueprint that's gonna allow you to, after 5 or 6 weeks, have all the information in one place so that everyone else down the road knew what those 5 or 6 key creatives wanted, and it's not gonna hinder everyone else. It's gonna actually uplift everyone because you know the emotion that you're looking for, you know the story that you're looking for, and all of those essential beats are in that blueprint.
Oh, and to add to that, I think one of the most important parts that has changed is that before it's like a waterfall model where it's like
thank you.
Yeah, so waterfall model where you do this, and then this needs to happen, and until this happens, this can't move. You know, like from, you can't start animating until the modelers finish, and then, visually, like the lighters can't finish until, yeah, exactly. It's just like trickle down, and that gets very expensive, it gets very tiring, gets very, it's just very convoluted. Whereas now, it's like an agile process. You build, you test, you iterate, you build, you test, you iterate, and that means that everybody is included at the same time because now instead of a waterfall model, you have like a spiral where all the different departments are included at the same time. And another really important part of the process, which is not talked about enough as well, is tech viz. Because as Felix reminded me, with like creating a blueprint, not only can you give your DPs a blueprint of how their set is gonna be lit already, with all the different aspects, the technical aspects as well. So DPs are very happy now to see, a blueprint of how of their lighting setup. Well, at the same time, tech viz is super important because you're also giving, the creatives, and you're giving everyone in this process, all the heads of the departments, et cetera, how everything's gonna look, like the measurements, where the camera is gonna be, how tall, if you have, motion control or a dolly, how fast is it gonna go? And then you can see exactly where the actors, the digital standards are, and so those are gonna be your actual actors, et cetera. And then you get this blueprint, and you're making everybody be part of the process, and it's just a much more agile and iterative process that it's, brings everyone together. And people are not, and heads of departments or different departments are not feeling isolated or that they're more or less important in the process because this is a team effort and, nothing could happen without everyone involved.
Yeah, I think the easiest sales pitch is, hey, pick this up, hold this, whoa, cool. And then you have other people looking at something and you're really starting to flow with all these different ideas. And that's the beauty of it. And I think a lot of that has to do with Unreal and Epic actually understanding what cinema and creatives needed to really tell stories. So we're able to leverage that. And I think that's the beauty of it.
I think some of the challenges, though, is waterfall versus agile. And waterfall, each, it's down the ladder, right? So, okay, well, you gave me this, I'm gonna do this. And then here, now you gave you this, now you're gonna do that. In Agile, Agile comes from software development. If your phone breaks, whoever it is that has to fix it has to reprioritize in the moment and fix it. And so that's a similar model we're doing here. When we do these virtual reviews, you know, we're working with John Favreau, we've worked with Greg Fraser, Robert Rodriguez, all in the same room at times. When those guys give you notes, you need to do that right away. Right? And so that's the major difference. It's about being nimble. Every morning, we reprioritize all of the tasks every day. And that's part of it. It's about finding the high value add and always targeting that. You know, if it's about story, if it's about lighting, if it's about emotion, finding what that is, and every morning, reprioritizing. So that's one of the biggest challenges that I find teams have a hard time at first. But once you're able to hit that the rhythm, it's actually extremely fast, and you focus on what's important.
So then how do you deal with decision making? Because the waterfall, naturally, there's a decision making process, right? It's like, okay, it goes to the next, it's bought off on. It goes to the next, it's bought off on. Mm-hmm. But here you're talking about something where people are making decisions all the time. Mm-hmm. How do you kind of slice that up? Like, who's making what decision and when?
I think one of the most important parts when you start a production in this process is understanding who's responsible for what. Because all of a sudden, there isn't a moment where you're going to stop. And then it's like, okay, I'm going to pass you this, and I'm going to tell you what you're going to do now. You're making those decisions every day in tandem. So the production designer, and this is obviously different for every project, but the production designer might be most likely is responsible for the look. So when you're working with them, that's his focus. And he's gonna have to make decisions around what's physical and what's virtual and what's gonna be built, et cetera. The DP is responsible for the cameras and the lighting, et cetera, right? And so that structure and that responsibility is super important to explain to these creatives because they're not used to doing it virtually. They're used to doing it physically. So that's, I think, the biggest difference. It's about when we deploy projects, we put a lot of work into helping these creatives understand what you're responsible for and at what point you want to make those decisions.
But also, and to add to that, I think, you know, the decision-making process hasn't changed. You know, it's not like now all of a sudden the director doesn't have a say in this or like that really
100%.
Hasn't changed. It's all these new different roles that are making it very interesting as well in the decision-making process because now you have, you know, the supervisor for the virtual art department, the virtual production supervisor, the LED wall supervisor, you know, the stage manager, the stage operator. So now you've added really just these new roles into the whole virtual production side, right, of the process, and then those people are gonna be the ones making decisions when it comes to the LED walls, you know, the assets that are gonna be handed over to the visual effects vendor to when explaining to the DPs or to the director, if they're coming from a very traditional filmmaking background, it's gonna be their job to help them in this decision-making process in explaining why, like, let's stop with the fix it in post and let's do 500, you know, versions of visual effects, et cetera.
Yeah, it's like you're cooking all these ideas in the pot. And before, everybody used to be pretty siloed. Like, what are those digital guys doing over there? And, you know, I'm gonna focus on this. I don't know what they're doing.
It's
but this
one.
Is, yeah, this is kind of putting everything together in the pot and then just saying, oh, do we agree? Okay, we agree, let's go make a movie.
So that's another one that's hard to you know, before we were in silos.
Yeah.
Now we're not. So all of a sudden, in the traditional pipeline, or when VFX came to be, the production designer would work on that look, and he was protected for months, and nobody would touch it. Now all of a sudden, we are in a process where the second week of working together, everyone's going to see the work. And the third week, they're going to see it again. And the fourth week, and we're going to iterate together from something that's nothing to the final product. That is something that takes explaining and takes time. So those reviews take time. It's like an added layer, but it's beneficial if it's structured appropriately.
So I'm imagining right now that the filmmakers out here and the writers out here are all like kind of, yeah, all right. And the producers are like, holy shit. Like, so Granted, we do have, I think there's also a session on producers, so any producers, make sure you attend that one.
I want
to go back to one thing that you also said, because even in the introduction, I introduced you guys as a visualization company, as opposed to a pre-visualization company. And you touched on tech viz, and the idea of tech viz is that if you build something in quote-unquote pre-viz, in the past, it used to be that that television was kind of arbitrary, and wherever things were was kind of arbitrary. Now, that television is exactly the size that it is. The distance is exactly the distance. How light cascades is exactly the way it is. Can you talk a little bit about that? And again, in that context of taking all that information from each one of the departments, and like, how does that work? How do you keep up with that?
I think it's about like when we read a script, for example, you're gonna have an idea, you're gonna have a visualization of what that's gonna look like based on your experiences, based on, you know, your biases. Mine's gonna look completely different. So what we're able to do now is kind of get those ideas up there on the screen and really get people to buy off on them. But really it's about kind of getting that information flowing and getting it all out there. In terms of, you know, what we do next, it's really about the process and kind of, if you think about executives that are gonna go and greenlight a movie and, you know, allow certain types of money to go into certain types of budgets, they don't really wanna put money into tech unless they know it's gonna be something useful. So as people are starting to use this tech, they're really seeing that the whole process is changing, and with this planning and getting that stuff going, you're able to actually save money. So kind of going into that producer stuff too, it's scary at the beginning, but that stuff's not gonna get green lit until people agree that these ideas are working. So it's kind of like taking your budget for post and moving it over to pre.
Right. I mean, the one thing, I'm always a little hesitant to say anything is gonna save anybody any money, just because things go pear-shaped very quickly, right? You know, where someone doesn't, I mean, they're my assumption is, and I kind of know this, there are some filmmakers, I'm gonna assume, this is not good for them, right?
Right.
Because the creative process is a process, right? Can you expand on that a little bit? Like, who is this good for, and maybe who is this not good for? Because it's not a silver bullet. All right, this is just another tool that's out there.
Yeah, I mean, absolutely. This is not a cult, first and most importantly, right? So of course it's not for everyone, but I would say it is for everyone because it is for everyone. And if, you know, if traditional now like filmmaking schools, because it really starts with education, they would at least have some like curriculum where you can see, you should be aware of the technology that's out there so that you're not scared of it. Now, if you decide not to use it because you wanna, you know, it's not for you, you don't feel it, you know, you wanna do it your own way, you know, like if say you're an independent content creator, if you're an independent filmmaker, that's absolutely, you know, fine. However, you should be aware of the technology that's out there and to know what's possible and what's not possible. Also to be dangerous, right? When you're pitching, when you're asking for budgets, when you're like, when you want to add things to your project, et cetera, because one of the things that would happen with visual effects, I mean, I remember back in the day when I was a visual effects supervisor, and I would get on set, and like, they literally hated me because they're like, because they hated visual effects, and they'd be like, you have 5 minutes, you know, the AD, you have 5 minutes to set up a green screen. You're like, and the gaffers and the grips don't want to help you light it correctly, and that was what was happening back then because, you know, there was like this, absolutely, they didn't know what was happening, so it's like a little bit of ignorance, and I don't mean that like in a, you know, derogatory way or anything. It's just they didn't know. So it was like, oh, who's this visual effects
kind of
person?
Well, it's infringing on them, right?
Exactly.
Yeah, yeah.
Exactly. So I feel like, no, it's, you know, if it's not for you, that's your decision as a filmmaker. If it's not for you, we should definitely be aware, right?
So I mean, to go on to that, I mean, that one of the things that I think was a mistake back then in the earlier days as we were starting to introduce this was the vocabulary was different.
Yes.
Right, you come to a set and you're like speaking all this, you know, okay, where's the ambient occlusion, and I want to, you know, where it's like, if you're talking in, can we lift this by one stop or something like that's a different thing. When you're talking about the tools that you start to develop, how do you approach that? Because there is a lot, there's a tech stack that is below that, but how do you make that not only palatable, but something that a filmmaker who maybe doesn't want to be tech, you know, how do you approach that?
But again, I think the language is not different at all. And of course, you know, I'm not gonna come up with like my software development concept or like start talking about target process and like, you know, like, oh, the prioritization methods that I use, because then they're gonna be like, oh, please, lady, go away, right? Or, you know, you're not gonna start using like visual effects terms or even like on real engine terms, right? Like, I'm not gonna be like, oh yeah, the blueprint, this and that. Like, no, you use the same language that's approachable to them. And that's why at the beginning I said virtual production is production, because you're talking about cameras, you're talking about lenses, you're talking about wide shots, tighter shots, you know,
but
anamorphic.
I do wanna add, I think that there's a little bit of what this process is doing, it's leveling the playing field around the kind of creatives that work with each other. So all of a sudden you have filmmakers from Previz, you have game guys, and you have VFX guys in the same room. And so a lot of what happens is three different kinds of lingo. And that's a big part of a lot of work we all do. And I think we've been doing it for so long where you're so used to it, but there is often when these projects start a little bit of a dance that happens. And so what we're finding is that the one that we lean into the most is the production lingo, because they're the ones that are ultimately gonna be responsible for pulling off the product and are at the very top. So we do a lot of work to, if there wasn't a word in production that matches something from VFX or from Previz, to find one. And that's a lot of the work that we've been putting in.
Yeah, it's also interesting to think about if you're gonna go shoot at an LED volume, how do I get there? Like, who do I talk to? Like, the thing is, I know Felix's company and Mariana's company, and you know, we put everything together. There's a virtual production supervisor there that's kind of that, you know, liaison between your guys that are moving, you know, the buses and the trees in the background and your director. So there is that person that's kind of able to translate too.
And who is this for? I also think everyone. I think there's different ways to approach it. You know, not everyone wants to get in there and do it themselves, and that's, I respect that. I think that's important. I think we did say that this is ultimately gonna become production because it's so effective that it makes sense. And so there are different ways to structure a production. And so every time a production starts, I encourage everyone to treat it as its own use case, because some people are gonna wanna get in there themselves. Others are just gonna need one individual to help them engage with it, and that's okay too.
So I'm sure that some are thinking about, we're only talking about science fiction films here. Can you help me demystify that?
Yes, I love that.
What kind of films are we talking about up here?
Rom-coms, we're talking about, yeah, comedy. We're talking about trade shows, or like a lot of these shows where, you know, something like this, where you want to be in the desert or somewhere else.
Story-driven projects, it doesn't be...
And yeah. The reason behind it is because, and if, especially if we're talking about the LED screens, actually, let's leave that aside. If you're using it as a Previz tool or as a visualization tool, you are able to visualize any kind of film. There's that part. But then when you get to the LED screens with Unreal Engine and the technology that it has, there's a certain romance that comes from it that it didn't before. You can move, you can have very subtle movements, and it's gonna look real. Versus when you had a screen back there with a video, you couldn't really move. You actually had a locked frame. And if you move your camera, you're gonna see the screen. With this tech, you're looking into the screen. You're not gonna see the screen. It's gonna trick the camera into thinking that it's actually in that location. And because of that, you could have a rom-com where it's, you know, you're gonna have very subtle movements or you back and forth with a background that's out of focus. Now, one of the other major benefits of this is that once you create the world similar to traditional filmmaking, if you have a warehouse with all your props, you could just bring those props out and shoot for as long as you want. You already built the world. That's the same thing in this process, only that now it's for the digital assets. If you built the digital assets and the world, you could shoot for as long as you want in that location.
Yeah,
and that's not something we had before.
And your actors are able to really relate and have, like, you know, heightened acting.
Mm-hmm.
And directors really see that. And the time that you're having your, you know, your most genius ideas are when you're on set. And if you're actually kind of on set, you're on set and you're having that, those serendipitous moments that you can't just make up when you're planning. And, you know, you have to be there. So you really feel that.
Yeah, this made me think of...
If you have, like, it doesn't matter if you have a comedy or, you know, character-driven story, wherever it is, at the end, you have a foreground, you have a middle ground, and then you have a background. And it's also really useful to visualize. For example, let's say out of your whole project, you want to do a drone shot, and that's going to be the most expensive part of it, right? And maybe you want some buy-in to get your project greenlit. Well, then, with Unreal, it's super easy to actually visualize. If it's just this street, you don't have to have aliens, you don't have to have explosions, you don't have to have, like, you know, you don't have to have any of that. Simply, you know, foreground, middle, background, you have your street, and then you can just very quickly just show that. How would a drone shoot look? How would, like, a dolly cam look? Or, like a bungee cam or something like that. Like, something that's a lot more expensive, not a dolly, but something that's a lot more expensive, right? And then you can just really visualize it very quickly. Maybe you have one buy-in from one of the actors. Maybe you want buy-in from, like, a really, really good DP, et cetera, et cetera. So that's why I continue to say it's for everyone.
And to circle back on that one again, I'll give you three examples of why it is for everyone. On Why Women Kill, we were working with a team who they didn't have any of the big tools, but we built them what we called a Lego set, and it was a warehouse where they liked that term because it's like they used to grab the pieces and just put them wherever they wanted. And so on the day of the shoot, they didn't have any of the expensive tech. They just had a laptop with the Unreal Engine environment, and so they would eyeball it and go, okay, I'm gonna shoot down the street, that's green, but if I look at Unreal, oh, okay, you know what, I like that, put a car there, that's the shot that I want VFX to do, right? And so that's one iteration of it. But then there's the second version of that, which is using a tool that does a real-time comp with green screen. So if you're shooting in front of a green screen, you can have a real-time comp and have a screen that shows the shot and another one that has the green screen. And then there's The Mandalorian, right, where you could have all of it in camera and work through maybe with post, and it's a different process. So there's different scales to the process that you could apply to different projects.
Yeah. I mean, what you just kind of touched on there also implies, again, I'm going to go back to virtual production is not just LED stuff. Like, there are tools throughout that can help people make, and like, for example, we were kind of talking about tech viz. If there are any students out there, let's say you need to steal a shot. Not that you would, but you just need to steal a shot. this, I'm imagining, is a great way of getting everybody on the same page so that you could go hit the street, mm-hmm. get it, and get out.
Mm-hmm. You're gonna be able to show where the DP is represented, the director, and I mean, tools are so easy now. If you're gonna shoot here, grab your phone. I would literally, with my phone, do a photogrammetry really quick, throw it in Unreal, show where the DP is gonna be standing, show where the lights are gonna be standing, and that's something that comes together in a couple days.
And then everyone knows. We're talking about assets, because, you know, maybe some of you are thinking, well, what about the assets? Who's building this asset? Like, that's not cheap. Well, you can go to the marketplace and then just, you know, get everything, or not everybody, at least, you know, there's so many different scenes that are amazing artists are just building up for you, and you just need to, like,
kit bashing.
Yeah, exactly. Kit bashing, and just download it, and it's like, oh, wow, okay, now I got Mars already, and I can start, you know?
I will say that I had I'm not going to say who, but a visual effects, a owner of a visual effects company, really upset with me because I was saying that I could get a 5-square-mile forest for $169, and that really pissed him off.
Well, of course. Yeah. Come on. That final pixel. You know how hard it is to get that final pixel. Yeah.
I think that it's one thing that does scare people, though, is no one wants to have what everyone else has, right? So what I try to explain to production designers, especially, is what these warehouses do. It's the same as physical production. If you're going to make a barrel, you're probably gonna first see if there's a place in town that has something similar, and then you're gonna repaint it, you're gonna restructure it, and then it's gonna look completely unique. And that's the jump start that a lot of these libraries are giving us. You're able to purchase these things or create something quickly for yourself, but eventually, by the time it makes it to the film, it's unique. So you don't have to worry about someone looking at some other movie and going, oh, that's the packet, because it won't look like it. If you have the right team, it won't look like it.
There's a thing that we didn't kind of touch on here is this idea of virtual scouting. Because in visual effects, I got a shot, and I build this shot this way. I got this shot, and I build it that way. You kind of approach it from a two-dimensional point of view. In virtual production, generally, you're making a level, right? And so you can actually go in and find things mm-hmm. that maybe you couldn't find otherwise. Mm-hmm. I think that, how much do you see that actually happening as you mm-hmm. guys are preparing for film?
I think that's the part that feels like when if we're all visiting the desert together, that's virtual scouting, right? So you build an environment, you can use some of these worlds that are online to jumpstart your production right away. And then once you find those cameras, that's where you know exactly where to put your focus. And that's one of the biggest things I wanted to solve with Happy Mushroom was the fact that I really felt that there was a lot of waste. You see a lot of these breakdowns from all these films, and it's like, here's this amazing city and a cloud and fire, and you can't see anything else anymore because it's nighttime. Mm-hmm. And you're like, man, I built all that. Why did I do that? With this process, you can iterate really quickly, put that cloud in front of it, make it nighttime, put the fire, and then once you have the camera, you know that all you have to focus on is the fire. And that's a major part of the pipeline that the virtual location scouting is providing you with, because together you're going to be able to stand in there, and with the VR headset or an iPad or even on a screen, you're going to be able to look at these environments. And if you're in a VR headset, you're going to know how large it is, you're going to get a feeling of the scale, and that's how you're going to hone in on that blueprint. The blueprint is super beneficial for VFX as well. I know that we mentioned for everyone else, but the VFX departments all of a sudden don't have to play the game of telephone that used to happen in the past, where maybe there are notes that people gave when they were on the production that aren't on the production anymore. It really helps all the creatives.
But and the virtual location scouting, actually the way that we, back in the day, we started to actually bring in people into this process, like the non-believers, would be even, faster with Google Earth VR. Mm-hmm. Like you want to convince them on the headsets, it's like, just put the headset on. Even if you never put a headset again in your life, that's totally fine. Just trust us. Just put the headset on. Let's all go. You're in Montreal, we're in LA, the other person's like, okay, and now let's all meet. Where do you want to shoot? Or you want to film in Paris? Okay, where's the address? Let's go check that place out. And then they would put the headset on, and it would be like, oh my God. And then, that was a way for us to really start bridging this, the knowledge gap, because Google Maps is something that everybody uses, right? Like, that's something mm-hmm. that you're now is like,
The difference now is you could be in New York, you could be in London, LA,
yeah, that's what I was saying.
Oregon.
Like, we were in LA, somebody else was, in Montreal, et cetera, and then we're all there, mm-hmm. and then it'll be like, oh my God, now I'm seeing everything, but like in 3D, and I can see the scale, and there was like, oh, I start to get it. So for us, virtual location scouting, and I felt like a lot of filmmakers are actually adopting at least that part of the process because it's a lot, cheaper.
Yeah. We had a client that was actually location scouting here in New York a couple years ago, and we shipped out an iPad so that he could see his creature that would basically get bigger when it would interact with humans. And so he took it out on one of these streets and started looking around, and okay, I'm gonna make my shot here. Oh wait, there's a big telephone pole there. There's a street light there. That's not gonna work. Okay, let me move this here. Or you're able to really have, that brilliance there right away.
Iterative.
Yeah.
I want to ask one last question of everybody before we go, and then I want to ask if you guys have any questions as well. The last one is a little bit more about the future. I think, so the thing that I'm interested in here is we've been talking a lot about some of the more traditional aspects of it, but underlying is this idea of game engine technology, right? Something that is a little bit different than your traditional digital content creation tools that people use. Can you talk a little bit for filmmakers or storytellers or writers, what does this mean for what they're bringing? Because my assumption is also, and I've kind of seen this a little bit, you're starting to see some of the game sensibility starting to come into film. And I don't want to say it's a true convergence, because I don't know if I all the way, you know, believe in that for right now. I think that people tell stories, you have experiences, and then you play games for those experiences, but they're kind of different. Can you talk a little bit about what the future might look like with these tools and what these folks may be doing?
Oh, absolutely. For me, the most and why I'm in this field is because I'm super excited about the future of content creation, because I think it levels the playing field, because there's so many different ways now to create content, distribute it, consume it. So for me, it's like that, like the VTubers, the digital humans, the metaverse, like all of these different ways that you can now, you know, like branch up narrative, interactive content, choose your own adventure. I mean, it really means that you can, the types of stories that you can create and how you can view them are now like just expanding, you know. And for those that don't know, like VTubers are the virtual YouTubers, which is basically, you know, like they're managing like a digital avatar, and that's how they're creating their content. And so it's just like what the future, and of course, location-based entertainment, a broadcast, like this show, Alter Ego, right? Alter Ego, that's the name of it, from Fox, right? Like it's the same formula from a show, but now you have like these avatars and using the technology that's already available to everyone. So this is to me, the future of content creation is so rich, and it's just like expanding the horizons of you can actually create and say and how you can view it.
Yeah, I think it's fun. It's like this virtual playground for different creatives. And I like to tell the story of working with Spielberg on the BFG. And he's known for just always picking up the camera, the virtual camera. He's obsessed with it when it comes to that stuff. You know, RPO, when he did that film, and Tintin, he shot his entire movie pretty much on the virtual camera before he took it to set. So for him, it was really awesome to just see that he was going to come to New York. We're in LA, we're, you know, working outside of, or working at DreamWorks at the time. And Kate called and said, yeah, well, you're gonna have to, you know, take a 2-month break because we're gonna go, you know, to our Hamptons house. And he didn't wanna let go of the camera. He's like, I wanna play around, I wanna continue this process. So can you guys come with me to New York and to, you know, the Hamptons? So we shot out of a garage at his Hamptons house for 3 months. And, you know, Kate would call him, and, okay, I gotta go to lunch, guys, or we're gonna end early. But, you know, we would start with him at 9 a.m, he'd come in at 8:00, 8:30, like, guys ready for me? For him, it was just this fun thing. And I think that's the beauty of what Epic and Unreal are doing. It's allowing people to really have fun and play and plan.
I think calling it a game engine is a disservice to what it is. I think it's a software, just like any other, or a tool, which is a consequence to the fact that we needed something to help us with storytelling. As someone that's addicted to ideas and stories, I think that multimedia is now a thing where it's accessible to everyone. So before, even in my early days, I used to look at film and I used to look at the app that I'm using on my phone for anything separate, as a different things. I need a completely different team. You know, this is Apple, this is Epic, and this is Disney, and this is, you know, the other studios that do movies. What this software, Unreal Engine, is now doing for us, and what the real-time ecosystem is doing for us, is that it's blurring the lines. If you're a person that has a story, if you see something on your phone that you liked, maybe it's an idea that someone had and you downloaded it, that's accessible to you now. So as you're writing your story, you could allow yourself to imagine it in all different forms, as an app, as a game, as a film. Those same assets could be used in the commercial or in the pitch. When you're creating your deck, you can explore those ideas as well, because it's low-hanging fruit without the concerns of, will I actually find someone that could do this, right? And so that's, to me, a huge benefit to the value that your product has now, where it's not just, oh, I'm gonna make a film. You could actually explore, well, I could make a VR experience because I already have the assets, and I could, you know, I saw this thing and it was cool, it's an app, I could do that as well. And it's actually pretty low-hanging fruit because it's all being powered by the same software. So the value add to the story is huge, and getting budgets and getting your story made becomes easier when you can show that there's a higher value add.
That's all we got.
Thank you, guys. Can we open it up to get some questions? Does anybody have any questions here? And I'm not sure how we facilitate
There's
that. I'm assuming the microphones are it.
Some questions over there.
Thank you, guys. This is so inspiring. I'm a film student at Columbia University, and I'm doing my first virtual production in a few months. I'm really excited.
Nice.
It's a short film. Yeah, thank you. I guess my question is, for first-time filmmakers working in this space who've never done it before, what are some rookie mistakes to avoid? What should I go in there expecting or not expecting?
It's going to be hard.
Yeah.
Don't expect miracles. Just, you know, be gentle to yourself. Like, allow yourself for, you know, learning experience, and then you're going to iterate, and you're going to break things, and then you're going to iterate again and test and build and learn from that knowledge. So just, you know, don't be scared. That's it. Be gentle with yourself.
What they all said, I absolutely agree. It is going to be hard. And this is that, like, I really like to say that for a little while we were painting by numbers. And a lot of people were painting by numbers. And right now, we've gotten back to people who like puzzles, people who like to figure things out, people who like to work through it. And that's the stage we're at right now. I feel like we're kind of like 93, 94. You know what I mean? That's where we are right now, where a lot of innovation is happening. So know that there's no right or wrong way to do anything. And then the other thing that I would think is, don't put yourself in a box in terms of thinking, oh, that belongs to visual effects or that belongs to this. Really, your production mm-hmm. designer and everything, that you have to have a hub. Mm-hmm. And I've learned that from these folks up here, is that you need to have that hub that makes sense of what exists virtually and what exists physically so that they can match up.
If I could also add to what you're saying, you could do everything in this new world, right? So it's taking production and expanding it quite a bit, because now you're taking some of production and some of post and some of pre, and you're putting it all together. So yourself, as someone that's learning it, I would say try to find the area you enjoy the most.
Yeah.
And let someone else do the other parts.
Yes, 100%.
That's awesome.
Thank you guys so much.
Thank you.
More questions?
Hey, when you're on a virtual production set and you're doing a shoot, what are some of the top things being requested of your brain bar?
You want to go? You want me to go?
You can take that.
Come on, Liz. Come on.
I was going to say, you should take it. You got your team.
I think at what step?
I guess if you're doing a shoot and we'll say the DP doesn't like something, you know, the set's up, actor's there,
okay.
And is it a prop being pulled in? Is it a virtual light being pulled in? I hear these things being mentioned, but
yeah.
I'm kind of curious what's the most common things.
So one of the most important things for this is prep, right? So hopefully before the day, you're not surprised. That's the worst thing you want to avoid. Since everything moves so fast and you could iterate everything, you don't want to get to the day and be surprised. Oh, all of a sudden, the sun was over here and he wants to have, instead of a noon, he wants to have a sunset and he doesn't want this building to be in the way. All of that is attainable if hopefully before the day you talked about it and the scenes were prepared appropriately. When things are prepared appropriately, some of what you'll hear a lot is changing of setups. So, hey, I want to go from daytime to nighttime, or changing a world from one world to another. You'll hear a lot of potentially, sometimes you're looking through the scene and it doesn't look good enough. So you're going to want to be ready for that as well. Like, what's my backup plan if it's not good enough, which could be during a green screen and then using the environment for lighting. So there's going to be, I think that what you'll be requested is actually very traditional production heavy. Like, if you try to see what does the DP care about, what does the production designer care about? What does the, if you study their brains, you're gonna know exactly what they're gonna ask you for.
I'm gonna add one thing
and
there.
Then I'll add one more thing.
Yeah, so one thing that I think is, and I'm gonna get into some specifics. If you're on the brain bar, you have a virtual production supervisor that's out there with the department heads, really important. Insist on clear comms so that you can always hear what they're saying. Because what's gonna happen is, and this is a really weird thing, people just automatically assume that because it's virtual, it happens just like that. And that, no, you don't get 5 minutes to do that. Yet I'll give the electricians and everybody else, I'll give them 45 minutes to set something up. But for you, no. All these lights have to be done inside of 30 seconds. So what you have to do is, first of all, education, I think, is important so that they know what it actually takes. But being able to hear the conversations that they're having allows you to anticipate what's going to be asked for. And that, I've seen, that is something I think is critical.
It's a good one.
Be a part of the conversation, or at least listen.
Sorry, and I'll add something very quickly because I see that there's people with more questions. The number one request that we've gotten is LED walls. Oh my God. Now if I have an LED, how much does it cost? I'll shoot on it. Then I don't need visual effects. Everything's gonna be magical. Everything's gonna be cheap. Everything's gonna be free. It's like, no, relax. It's really hard to use. They're very expensive. And you definitely, there's a lot of instances where you don't need it. So that would be it. And I think you, who was first? You?
Thank you, buddy.
So would you recommend as a starting place for people trying to get into virtual production to implement this into pitches first instead of like actually like going for like the full gambit?
Oh, absolutely. You know, like pitch biz is actually like an industry standard, you know, terminology. And it's like this pitch biz is because you're visualizing your pitch. So, you know, if you introduce it at the very beginning, and you can even have like a little example, for example, with our tools, Glassbox. Very easy to use. So then, you know, you can big old pitches. you can introduce it from the very beginning, and that way no one's surprised. You're communicating from the very beginning, and then, you know, you start educating people. And if you get a no, you know, somebody will say yes because there's a bright future in
and
this.
Right now people will be incredibly impressed.
Yes.
Because you're skipping a whole bunch of steps and they're gonna be, what? I can see all this stuff, you know.
I think the first thing that I would use it for is just tech viz. It's funny, tech viz gets overlooked predominantly because it's done all the time these days. Like each one of us, when we're working on scenes, we're actually doing tech viz every second. And so it's because we've been doing it for a while and our brains are, you know, our teams are used to that. I would say that the first thing I would use it for is for tech viz because it's the lowest hanging fruit. You don't have to have a real human represented, although you could download that very easily. You could have a cube and make that director red. You could have another cube that's green, that's the production designer, and then mapping it out is gonna immediately allow your brain to work through the issues that you may have.
Yeah, the most successful shoots, tech viz, prep.
Yeah.
I'll point, and we'll go over here, but I want to point out one other thing. And everybody, just understand, the engine is free. The only thing you have to have is a machine that runs the engine. So even when we're talking about these LED setups, there are people who I know who will go to Costco and get 3 televisions or 4 televisions. They'll set them up. And they'll actually do a shoot using multiple machines, but just like with little things, just to understand how it works and everything, and then they'll return the TVs after. But I'm just saying. But all of it is, that's the thing. It's all free right now, with the exception, I think, of the computers. It's all free and doable. So I always say there's nothing to it but to do it.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Thank you all so much. My imagination's on fire listening to the possibilities. And I just love how you're uniting collaboration and you're giving the autonomy back to like the heads of department at the beginning of the process. So it was putting me into visualizing, like putting a scene on its feet and bringing in your actors. And I was specifically thinking about blocking a scene. And, you know, with a lot of, like, the previs, you know, as the director, you're really, like, you have this very specific idea of what you want. But I'm actually curious, with this technology, how do you bring that autonomy back to the actors to then find their own, you know, to do the blocking in a scene and to give them that power to find it themselves within, like, an imagined world that you've created? And I feel like that's such an exciting space that I hadn't yet considered with this technology.
Yeah, I've heard so many stories where directors and different creatives are just talking about how amazed they are by the actors and just the heightened performances. So I feel that it really does do that. There's something about being there that you really feel like you're there.
There's, I was talking to Karen about this actually, but there's a, because it's real time, you know, when you do VFX, it takes sometimes hours a frame to render. Because it's VFX, although you're in pre-production and you're building things iteratively to the production, when you get to the production, it's still all real time. So the DP could still improvise. Mm-hmm. The director could still improvise. The set decorator could still improvise. The production, they are still able to change things. Within its limits, if you know, yeah. But it, the improvisation of all those creatives, along with the actors, where they both could improvise and use what they learned through their decades of experience, is I think one of the biggest differences.
And does that look like I'm even thinking rehearsal, right? Which uh-huh. is such an integral process. Are we now, you know, bringing our actors into headset during that process?
It's happened many times.
I was actually going to say though, because also now you have, well, A, if you can bring them in from the very beginning, because yeah. instead of just a script, maybe learning their lines and then kind of like, you know, doing their thing and then coming into set, but then they have like, you know, green screens, if they're able to visualize what they're going to do, even if it's a small scene or whatnot. But also now, I mean, you can, you know, you have like the meta humans from Unreal Engine and you have tools for doing, you know, facial capture, so you can actually have like, you know, a digital double, you know, and seeing, and so that you can bring them in, whether it's in a headset or not. Like, you know, if you don't need to use a headset, like it could just be an iPad, it could just be an iPhone, or it could just be your computer, and then bring them into the process and see what it looks like, right? So even if it's like difficult scenes with like stunt vis and yeah. things like that. So.
And to give two examples, you know, back to you. To give two examples, if you're doing green screen,
yeah.
typically, or what was happening was people would arrive at that green screen and not know where they're at. You know, maybe they saw a picture, and that's great and all, but obviously if you're doing a whole scene, that's difficult to, it's hard pill to swallow, right? Like, okay, I'm in this imaginary world. We have a lot of sessions now where the actors come into the virtual scout, and the director's there waiting for them, and they have a conversation. So it raises that conversation again around what are you going to do in that world? What are you supposed to feel? What's the scene supposed to be motivated by? And these are the things that now we talk about more and more. It's no longer, oh, but it's green screen. No, it's what's the scene motivated by?
Yeah, we talk about, you know, the LED wall, the volume, and we talk about all these different worlds and things. But ultimately, what we're doing is it's just the stage now. It's really just, it's not the LED volume stage, it's the stage.
Yeah. Thank you.
I think this is the last question. I think we might be out of time, so.
Thank you very much. Thank you for lending your time. The virtual production is just so damn exciting to me. I can barely breathe. That's how exciting it is. And so what I'm really curious about is something that you were alluding to earlier, Mr. Perkins, about, you know, kind of reverting back to a Hitchcockian approach to filmmaking where you pretty much know what the film looks like before you've even shot the shot. Mm-hmm. And so in those terms, like the benefits have become pretty clear where you're like, okay, we're saving all this money in post, we're getting rid of a lot of bottlenecks. I'm really curious as to, given this new power, are you seeing any new bottlenecks being formed where now that everyone's like, oh great, we've got all these tools and everything, well, we can do this, I'm sure. So I'm assuming there are a lot more new bottlenecks being created. And mm-hmm. I wonder where perhaps everyone thinks, oh, this is going to be a great time and cost-saving tool. Actually, now we're being compounded in different areas. Thank you.
I love that one.
I
love that one. I think the biggest one that we face is the speed at which things move is a lot faster than what people expect. When we talked at the beginning, if it's not clear who's responsible for what, they become the bottleneck. Because if you're trying to close out a shot and the production designer can't make a decision on what's going to be physical or what he's going to create, or the DP doesn't feel like he has the authority sometimes too to lock down a shot, that's a major bottleneck. And so that's where we find it the most, or in my world at least, it is it's a lack of preparation and a lack of helping those creatives understand when and what they're responsible for.
On my end, the thing that I've seen where the bottlenecks happen the most is on the visual effects side of things, because the vendors, a lot of visual effects facilities now want to jump into this world, but their pipelines are, pretty old. Not every studio, but a lot of studios, their pipelines are so old that they just can't handle, they don't know where to, they don't know where to actually add, for example, Unreal. Like, sit at the beginning, mm-hmm. and then in the middle. How do I add it? But then if I add it, their pipeline is already slow. Now you add this tool, and it just becomes even more slow. And then you have, a ton of different file formats. And so then the import and export process just becomes completely out of control, animal that you have to help them figure out, maybe you need to, scratch everything and just rethink your pipeline and really, just a redo of these pipelines, as well as another bottleneck is now directors are able to, and we've seen this a lot, where they have now so much power, where now they're making, 29 changes within takes, and just actually, there's no human that can actually just keep track of all those changes when you're actually doing virtual production shoots. So finding ways of actually tracking all those different changes, it's also, a big
That's
bottleneck
a big one.
That we've seen now.
That's a big one. The tracking is a challenge, because you're grabbing a pipeline that was like this and you're compressing it into half the time and everyone's working together. And so that means that everyone is making decisions on a daily basis that you need to readjust to. And all of that needs to be tracked. And that's a big part that we wanted to focus on. You need tools. You need process and you need tools that supports the process. And that's if you're going to scale up, especially. If not, if it's a smaller production, it'll be okay. But you do want to make sure that the process is in place so that you could have all that tracking in place, make sure that your DP is well heard, your production designer is well heard, because you're going to need buy-in. They're going to need to feel like you can track it. And if you miss those tracking points, you'll lose them. All of a sudden, there's a, and that's where the bottlenecks start happening. It's like you need to keep your creatives engaged. You need to make sure that they feel like they're making their movie, because all of a sudden you're bringing in some new creatives that are going to work on their stuff, and so I feel like that's a major part of it.
I'm noticing a bottleneck in the lack of people. There's such a big demand for this stuff. And,
that's a big one.
That's where I was about to. Yeah. And, I was about to shoot across that's the right.
battle.
Here
this. And, that's a big one.
With the pandemic, people weren't able to shoot, and now the people that were supposed to be shooting last year are shooting on top of the people that are shooting this year, and everyone wants to come in and start using this tech, and everyone wants to make their movie when they want to make it, so the more people we can get, educated on, learning Unreal, learning different artists, types of backgrounds, and getting people out there, that's always going to help.
At a higher level, what I think everybody's talking about is the right team. So meaning people who can make decisions that you trust, people who have expertise, which is, I am shooting across the bow to say, there aren't enough VADs that are out there who are bringing up and understand, because it's a different way of thinking than visual effects. Mm-hmm. Visual effects, you have a lot of time, and I can tinker, I can noodle, I can do this. No, you got to be ready when you get on stage, and you have to be ready for what the filmmaker wants right away. But teams, that's what I think. If you can, and a lot of times you'll go into a space and you'll see the team and you'll go, this ain't gonna work. It's just not. And you know it, you can smell it, you can feel it, but then you can also feel when there is a team that you can just tell that they're all working together, there aren't egos in the room, that they're really collaborating and accepting the talents that each one of them have, and they take ownership of that. That, I think, is really the key.
I think we're definitely out of time.
Yes. I want to thank everybody. Yeah. I want to thank you
guys. Thank you, guys.